say a word of gratitude for you being here. All of our children are coming in the back to be a part of the first part of the service. Many are watching online right now, and I know it takes a minute to get online, so I want everyone to have time to get focused, everyone to have time to put everything else aside for the next hour. And let me say to you and to those online, you do not want to miss the end of this service. A lot of times you cut your TV off or you kind of disconnect when the invitation begins. Please stay with us until after the invitation, or else you're going to miss a very special blessing. Two things, church, I need you. Leatherwood Baptist Church, I need you, and it's going to be a blessing to you. Tomorrow night, 6:30, Fred Luter will stand behind this pulpit. The choir will be so large. Some of you love a choir. It's a combined choir from all across our county. And so there's going to be choirs all over here under the direction of Grant from Hillcrest. We're going to have a special from Amber, I believe. And then Fred Luter is going to take this book. And Fred Luter is a preacher like you may have never heard. If you've never heard Fred Luter, he was the president of our Southern Baptist Convention for many years. And this building should be packed. I need you to come. A lot of you have ball games, and I understand that. But if you're free, come early. Come at 6:30. It's come at 6. It begins at 6:30. And also, one more thing. Tonight, you're going to hear this again from Brother Mike. But tonight is the first of many more Sunday evening worship services being led by our youth. And they have graciously invited we adults to join them. So, we're going to be in the youth building at 5:30. They're going to worship. They're going to preach the Word of God. And I can't wait. I had not rather be anywhere else other than that. Now, here's what I believe. I'm going to prophesy something. I believe we will only be in that building for a short amount of time because so many people are going to be drawn. People are tired of not having anything to do on Sunday afternoon, and so we're going to see what God's going to do. Speaking of what God's going to do, boys and girls, can you see this big screen? A couple of weeks ago, I believe it was 40-something degrees. Our guys had just played a baseball game. After the baseball game, there at the field, I want you to watch what happened.
How many broken men given a second chance? See all the lifted hands, can't count them. How many promises, doubting your promises, standing in our contempt, can't count them. How many hospitals said it's impossible? How many miracles, can't count them. How many paralyzed living a different life? Go on and testify, can't count them. How many sinners saved? How many bodies raised? How many empty graves? Can't count them.
I'm told that even the opposing team stayed and they watched and they saw the gospel. You're about to see the gospel again. Would you bow with me? Father, as Kyle Kilgore walks into the baptistry, to baptize his little girl. I pray that we would see the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing. To God be the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
She's scared she can't touch. So, this is a blessing, an absolute blessing. When she was two, Satan, the enemy, tried to take her voice away from us. She was in the hospital for a while with three different lung illnesses that we weren't sure that she was going to recover from. We didn't know what kind of voice she was going to have, but we knew that there was a reason that Satan was attacking her so heavily at two. And she worships hard now and sings like an angel, and I pray that as she gets older that she continues to, because it'd break my heart if his child can't sing. But this is an honor for me and a blessing, because after all that the Spirit did last Sunday, we tried to bottle it up and take with us up on the mountain Sunday night. And then for some reason it hits the ride in our car, and it's Monday night. We're reading the Bible and she starts asking questions that made me put the Bible down and realize she knows what's going on. So, Mary Elsie. It is my honor and privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
What a blessing. Rihanna? Rihanna has been joining us on Wednesday nights and Sundays for the past few months. And a couple of weeks ago on Wednesday night, she came up and tears rolling down her face. And she said, "I need Jesus." And so she made a public profession of faith and accepted Jesus as her Lord and Savior. And we've been talking and walking through her the next steps and helping her grow in her faith. And we're just so proud of you, Rihanna, and so glad to have you with us here at Leatherwood. So, Rihanna, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord. I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Sophia. Sophia's nervous. I told her it's okay. I'm bigger than her. I'll be able to pick her back up. Sophia, she actually came, I think, to the Fall Festival. And I think that was her first time here on the property. And I had an opportunity to talk with them. I've known Sophia, coached her in softball. And she came with her aunt to the Fall Festival. And we walked around. And I was able to show her the youth building and talk about some of the things that we had going on. And they seemed very excited, and her aunt shared with me some struggles that she was having, and that she really needed to be involved in a youth group and surrounding herself with Christ-like individuals. And so she started coming. I think it was a Wednesday night we had the family service, and so we were all in here. Just so happened to be the first Wednesday night that she came, and I wondered, I'm like, all right, are we going to come back, or, you know, what do you think? But she started coming, and she's been coming every Wednesday night. And a couple of weeks ago, she heard Jesus calling her name, and she accepted the call and accepted him as Lord and Savior. And we're so proud of her and excited to see what God's going to do in her life from this day forward. So, Sophia, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord. I baptize you, my sister, In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right. Good morning, Leatherwood. Let's all stand and worship. What a blessing we have had already.
Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't.
Rain came.
He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad, 'cause I put my faith in Jesus. He's never
you were the Word at the beginning, the one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you
Take your Bible, turn with me to Genesis chapter 3. Once again, I'm going to allow you to remain seated, but I want you to posture yourself mentally, spiritually, and even physically. So, in other words, if you're just kicked back and you're just sloppy, I want you to realize that you are in the presence of holy God. And so whether you stand or sit doesn't matter. What matters is that you give, boys and girls, you give Him your attention. If there's any games or any doodling going on, for just at least during the time of reading the Scripture, let's give Him the honor that He deserves. While I was singing, God said, "Phil, why are you keeping it a secret what we're going to do at the end of the service?" Well, I'm doing that just to kind of get you excited, wondering what might happen, but I can't hold it back anymore. Raven, who's sitting right over here, has been talking to her mom and dad about Jesus. She's been talking to her mom and dad about salvation. Her mom and dad's been working with her, as has our circle of friends, ministry leaders, Zach and Haley. And so as the team, we're all a team. Don't wait for me to lead your child to the Lord. Don't wait for the Sunday school teacher to lead your child to the Lord. We're a team, all right? So Raven started with her parents, and then it began to grow, and she talked to her ministry leaders. And then last Sunday, she couldn't stand it. She started going to Scott. She came to me. She went to many others of you, and she just couldn't help telling what Jesus was doing in her life and what she wanted to do. And so at the end of this service, Miss Raven is going to be baptized. Amen? And so I'm going to try to preach the shortest sermon that I've ever preached, because I can't wait to get in that warm water with you, Raven, because God's going to use you. Now, one more little bit of really, really good news. Before this morning is over, in just a few moments, or even maybe right now, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can be born again just like Raven. You can be born again right now. And if you want to be baptized, you can be baptized right at the end of this service. You just follow me back there and we will have a great celebration. Here's what Oswald Chambers said last week. If some of you read My Utmost for His Highest, here's what Oswald Chambers said last week. He said, remind yourself of everything that you believe. What are your beliefs, okay? Oswald is talking about our biblical beliefs. Remind yourselves of all of your beliefs, things that you've learned in church. And then what he says next is quite shocking. After you remember everything you believe, then do away with as much of it as possible and get back to the foundation of the cross of Christ. All the things we believe, some of it is true, and some of it you need to build into your life. But some of our beliefs are religious tradition, and what God is calling us to do, especially as we near Easter, is get back to the foundation. Many of you are confused because your grandmother believed this and your mother believed this, or this church believes this and this church believes that. Get back to the foundation. All that matters is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. I started to say stand with me, but posture yourself, humble yourself as I read Genesis chapter 3 and verse 9. Then the Lord called to Adam and said to him, Adam, where art thou? Adam, where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid. I was naked, and I hid myself. And he, capital H, God, said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat? Let's pray. Father, I'm deeply, deeply convicted that in this room there's some that are afraid. And just like Adam and Eve, they're doing what is natural. They're avoiding. They're hiding. They're ashamed. They feel guilty. But I pray this morning as we journey to the cross, we will see that there is no more need to hide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's intriguing to me. It's intriguing to me in the book of Genesis. And by the way, I can't wait. Suzanne, the boys, and I are going to take a vacation at the end of this month. I don't even know what the days are. We normally go to the beach and we eat seafood and we lay out in the sand. But we're making a trip this year that I believe is going to make a difference. And many of you went just a few weeks ago. We're going to the Ark. We're going to saturate ourselves. And we're going to find the answers in Genesis. And right here, as we journey to the cross, we find the reason for the cross right here in the very first book of the Bible. It is so intriguing. God made it simple. You can have the whole garden. You can enjoy all the benefits. But whatever you do, you cannot eat from one tree that is in the center of the garden. And the moment they did that, everything changed. This morning, instead of hearing my voice, please, and Holy Spirit, I ask for your help right now. Holy Spirit, I believe that you're in this room, and so speak to who needs to be spoken to right now. God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Ma'am, who told you that you're worthless? Sir, who told you that you have messed up too much to be redeemed? Who told you that you're too dirty, too bad, too broken?" The moment that Adam and Eve sinned, watch what happened. That very moment, innocence. I went around and loved on some of the babies that are in here. We've got babies in here, and we've got babies in the nursery. And I guess the reason I love babies so much is because of the innocence. But the moment sin entered into the world, innocence was replaced by the curse. I mean, that very moment, innocence was gone. That very moment, up until then, there had been no vulgar thoughts. How many of you, the last few days, have had thoughts in your mind and they disgust you and they're horrible? But the vulgar thoughts and imaginations bombard our mind. That wasn't so before sin. There was no vulgar thoughts. There was no lewd imaginations. There was total innocence. And if you go back to Genesis chapter 2, there was no shame. But the moment sin entered the world, innocence left, and the curse entered. The curse replaced innocence. Now, let me give you a good example of how that interprets in our life. For those of you that are my age and older, maybe 45 and older, I don't know, at least my age, you will remember a name. Now, most of you will not know this because you're younger than we are. But how many of you remember a young girl by the name of Brooke Shields? Do you know? A lot of you know Brooke Shields. Let me tell those of you that don't know who Brooke Shields is. She was an actor, and she's kind of like, in popularity Taylor Swift is today. How many Swifties do we have in the room right now? Don't raise your hand, all right? But popularity. Brooke Shields was it. But let me tell you what happened. Let me tell you what Hollywood did. At the age of 11, she was in a movie filmed nude. And the movie title was Pretty Baby. I don't remember that. But in 1978, Brooke Shields was in a movie that I remember. I was 10 years old. And it was called The Blue Lagoon. And Hollywood made millions and millions of dollars using this 14-year-old girl as an adult. Brooke Shields did a documentary. And here's what Brooke Shields said. My innocence was stolen from me as a child. And now then, I hide from intimacy with anyone. The reason for the cross is the curse moved in. The reason some of you are distant, everybody in the church is nice. Suzanne asked me every time I come home, was everybody nice? And I'm so glad that for years, not years, but for the last year and a half, I'm able to say, Sudi, everybody was so nice today, tonight. But I want you to know something. Even though all of you are nice, some of you have got a wall. And it's not just your personality. Some of us are introverts and some of us are extroverts. But here's what that wall is. You feel shame and you feel guilt. And the natural result of losing your innocence, the natural result of guilt is to withdraw and hide. Adam, Adam, where are you, buddy? And Adam said, I was naked. I was afraid, and I hid myself, and I no longer felt like having fellowship with you like I once did. My favorite part of being the pastor of this church, and I must say it's not just been this church, it's been almost, I guess it's been every church that we've pastored, my favorite part. What do you think my favorite part is? Preaching? No. My favorite part of being a pastor is your children running up to me in the hall. Now, I don't care if I'm talking to the most important, the biggest giver in the church, who I don't know who that is, but I don't care who I'm talking to. If a little child comes up and tugs on me, what happens? All of a sudden, you're not all that important. And that child gets my undivided attention. But do you know what I've noticed, Andrew? I've noticed that as they get older, there's one sitting over here, and I promised I wouldn't call his name. But there's one sitting over here that when I came to be pastor, if I didn't hug him, if I just kind of waved at him, he would look at me and he would say, what's wrong with you? Where's my hug? But naturally, as we grow, that changes. Some of them came running up to me in their pajamas this morning. They're having pajama day. And those children came running up to me and they hugged me. And knowing that I was going to preach this sermon, I thought, how many more weeks, how many more months, how many more years until, instead of running and embracing me, they kind of turned to the side. They still love, but that feeling has changed. When sin moved in, innocence was gone. When sin moved in, number one, it hurt Adam and Eve. Oh, it hurt them badly. Every evening, that's my favorite time of the day. I love early morning and I love late evening, especially yesterday afternoon. The sun was setting and the birds were singing and the frogs had started frogging. And boy, you could feel spring in the air. And I can't help but think that that's just a little taste of what Eden was like. And God would come down. And God would walk, and He would talk, and He would fellowship with Adam and Eve until innocence was gone. Adam! Adam! Where are you? I was naked and afraid. Last night I asked Suzanne, do you remember who the first ones that was on that show, Naked and Afraid? And she said, no, and how in the world do you remember? I said, because that's what I do. And she was totally silent. I said, Adam and Eve. They were naked, they were afraid, and they hid themselves. And I want you to know, it robbed them of the sweetest fellowship that they had ever had. But this is the part many of us don't understand. Not only did it rob us, but it robbed me and you. In just a moment, I'm going to read just straight scripture. I'm going to read to you from Romans chapter 5. And if you're here and you say, that's not fair, that's not fair. Fairness has nothing to do with it. When Adam and Eve sinned, the point was innocence was gone. And the curse replaced innocence. And so the moment that happened, Adam and Eve were robbed. The moment that happened, you and I, everyone before us, and everyone who comes after us will be robbed as well. But I want you to think about one more thing. Also, God was robbed. God was robbed of the fellowship. God was robbed. Now, some of you parents related to the illustration that I just now used. Some of you remember that time when your child started turning. For some, it's about 8 years old. For some, it's about 9 years old. Why is that? Because for most, that is what we call the age of accountability. 8, 9, 10, that's why you see so many people and hear so many testimonies. Miss Sue and others told me about your testimony, Mom. 9 years old, just like me. Baptized, 9 years old, just like me. Why? Because it is at that age that we start understanding right and wrong, sin and shame and guilt, and we start withdrawing. God was robbed when sin entered the world. Now, what is this sermon about? Have you already forgotten? This sermon is about a journey to the cross. Here's the good news. The cross reversed. Lynn, you did a great job. Last Sunday, I was going to preach this sermon, and she had a cross, and she had a circle with an arrow. That's exactly what the cross does. The cross reverses. The cross is the antidote. Nothing else. You can try everything. Adam and Eve were embarrassed. They were ashamed. They hid themselves and they tried fig leaves. They sewed the fig leaves together. And look, those of you here with fig leaves, I've got some good news for you. It works. Until a big gust of wind comes. For those of you that have fig leaves, you're a faithful church member. You come, you've got the outward appearance. You've covered up the shame. I've got good news for you. It works. Until the fig leaves begin to wither. And then all of a sudden, when you least expect it, you're totally exposed. And the harm is greater. Have you known that happen to anybody? Have you known any great preachers? Have you known any great leaders that you thought they were the greatest man of God? You thought they were the greatest woman of God that has ever been seen. They could preach better sermons than anybody, but one day the fig leaves blew off, and one day they were exposed for who they really were. So God looked at the fig leaves, and He said, I tell you what I'm going to do. Genesis 3, verse 21. I'm going to make you a garment. And for the first time ever, a life was taken. For the first time ever, God killed. And there was blood. He killed an animal. And He sewed them some garments. But that too was only temporary. You see, those hand-sewn garments, they looked good for a while, but soon there was tears, and soon the garments wore out. And so God had a plan. And here's what the plan was. The cross reversed. The cross was the antidote for the curse. My favorite passages of Scripture, Romans chapter 5. I'll begin reading and I'm going to close with this. Verse 12. Therefore, think about every word, okay? You know how I read by now. I want you to hang on some words. Therefore, just as through one man's sin, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world. But sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who was a type of him who has come. Look at verse 15. But, I had never preached it, but some preachers preach a sermon entitled "The Big Butts in the Bible." I've not done that yet, and I don't plan to, but this would be one of the big butts in the Bible. But the free gift is not like the offense. For if by one man's offense many died, much more the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one, capital M-A-N, man, Jesus Christ, abounded to many. And the gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned, for the judgment which came from one offense resulted in the condemnation, but the free gift which came from many offenses resulted in justification. Now here's where it really, really gets good. So pay close attention. Verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who received abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign through the one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation. Even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience will many be made righteous. Ladies and gentlemen, there has to be an exchange. You have to come to the place that you're willing to trade the curse for the cross. There has to be a time that you turn from sin and turn to Jesus. That is why Oswald Chambers said, remember everything you believe and then try to forget it. Because Oswald Chambers knows that our beliefs through the years have made us think if we do this, if we do that, if we're good, if we don't do this, or if we follow these rules, those are all good beliefs. But he said, do away with it. Because all that matters is the cross replacing the curse. I close with this point. How do I put on Christ? If you're here this morning and you want to do what Raven's about to do, and Raven, if you and your family would go ahead and make your way to the baptistry, if you're here this morning and you want to do what those baseball players did, unashamedly professing Jesus is Lord, if you want to do what Mary Elsie has done as a little girl, she understands the curse. And she understands the punishment. And she turns to Jesus. If you're here and you want to be clothed in Christ, here's what Galatians 3 verse 27 says. It's very simple. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. I preached Suzanne's grandmother's funeral Wednesday, I didn't get to preach the sermon that I had written, but one thing that I had written in her sermon, this 99-year-old woman, every morning, got up and she got dressed. But I don't just mean her outward garments. Every single day of her life, she was the woman that she was because she clothed herself in Christ Jesus. And when you do that, you can't be like the world. When you do that, you begin to change. It's not about changing first. We don't ask you to quit cussing. We don't ask you to quit sinning. You see, that's what the church does. Real quick, you got to hear this. Here's what the church does. We welcome you. We welcome you. We want you to join. We want you to be baptized. But watch what the church does. When we find out that you've got a dirty little secret in your past, when we find out that you've been incarcerated, when we find out that you've been divorced, when we find out that you did something when you were young and you didn't tell us that, do you know what the church does? The church sends you away. Or the church so shuns you that you want to leave. And so, we think God does that. And I want you to know, God does not do that. No matter what you're addicted to, no matter what you've done, no matter how many times you've gone to jail, no matter what, when you clothe yourself in Christ, the curse is canceled. Father, there's some people in hiding right now. Some of them are watching online. They will not even come to church because they feel so dirty. They feel so judged. But when God found Adam, He offered a solution. He didn't shame him. He didn't punish him. He offered him a solution. And that's what you're doing right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Michael Webb, would you come extend the invitation?
I had talked to the students. I meet with them every time we have a baptism. I take time and we sit down, and we were going through that picture that I shared the very first Sunday that I came, the picture of the cross. And as Brother Phil was preaching, that's exactly what came to my mind. You have all these things in our life. We have all these things that we're trying to fix, that we're trying to make better. And when you look at that picture of the cross in that Call to Joy book, there's religion and there's morality and there's good works and there's all these things that come from our relationship with Christ, but that's the fig leaves. That's the fig leaves. We're trying to make sure that we come to church on Sunday. We're trying to make sure that we read our Bible, that we pray. I can't tell you how many people I talk to that are completely broken, that have never experienced Jesus before, and they say, but I fall on my face and I pray every single night. We can try to do all the things that we see Christians do, but until we truly surrender to what God's called us to, a relationship with Him, until we're covered by the blood and quit trying to cover ourselves with what we think can make things better, we'll never experience the peace that comes from a relationship with Christ. So as the team starts to sing, we're gonna be up here. We're gonna open these altars. If there's something that God's calling you to, as we prepare for our worship service tonight, we're gonna be preaching from the book of Jonah. And what a story of somebody who knew that God was speaking to him. There's somebody in here tonight this morning that you know God is speaking to your heart right now. You know that God's calling you to join this church. You know that God's calling you to a relationship with Him. You know that God is calling you to something. Are you going to run, or are you going to be willing to answer that call? If you will, stand with us, and team, if y'all sing.
I've carried a burden too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. Come to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, a reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father.
Invitation is still open. We're not going into the baptism yet. But if you're here and God is speaking to you, please, please surrender. If you're living under the curse, you need to know that because of Jesus' death, the curse was canceled. And all you have to do is receive Jesus. So Amber, you and your team sing through that one more time. Church, you come.
Before we move on, Miss Sheila and I were talking this morning. Christian taught our youth Wednesday night and had a message from Mark 4 about the storm that come on the boat, and Jesus was asleep in the bottom. And so we challenged the students with, is Jesus in your boat? Is Jesus in your boat today? The first thing that you've got to know is that Jesus is in your boat. You've got to know that you have a true personal relationship with Him. But then if you know He is in your boat, and you know that you're in the storm right now, whatever your storm is that you're facing, are you willing to go wake Him up? Because when you wake Him up, He's going to have some things that He's going to want you to change. He's going to have some things that you're doing that He's going to say, hey, you can't do that anymore. So are we willing to just keep going through the storm and keep fighting the fight? Or do we want to go wake Him up and say, hey, help me? If Jesus is in your boat today and you know you're in the storm, just bring it to His feet and wake Him up and commit that whatever it is that He wants to change, you're going to be willing to change it.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own, and I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation, just let it all go. I see it now, laying it down, and I know that I need you. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with hiding, reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father.
I want to ask you to be seated in our circle of friends. It may take just a moment, but I want our circle of friends to come up here and support Raven. And I want you to be able to watch, because from way back there, it's hard to see a lot of times. So just take your time. Don't stumble. And if you need help, somebody will come help you. All right? So just make your way up this way. Jordan, I figured you would go right up the tallest step we got. All right, you stand right there.
They're coming to get out of here.
Huh?
They kicked me out of here.
They, oh, God, I know. Anybody? Come on, Cameron. Very, very good. Good. Z, while you're coming up here, Z, I want you to know you did so good today. You let me know you were back there, but you were very quiet and respectful, and I thank you. Cameron, let me tell you something. I got a text this morning, and I don't know who they are, but they're in this room right now. I texted my friend Chris Walker. Chris Walker pastors a church in the Hoke's Bluff area. And do you know what Chris Walker told me? He said, Phil, today you're going to have in your service a very special family, and they have a very special child, and they're going to come to your church today. And so we're seeing that happen a lot. Because of Melanie, I don't know where Melanie went. Because of Melanie, there she is. This ministry was birthed years ago. This church has embraced this ministry. And now, Zach and Haley are leading this ministry, and God is doing such a tremendous job. Church, even though we're above average in working with special needs, we need to learn everything that we can learn. I've been reading. I'm on my second book on autism. And boy, my eyes are just being
open to the brilliance that God has given these children and these adults. And so, I need you, Jordan, to stand right over there. Cameron, I need you to get over there closer to him. Good, because we want the camera. And Miss Raven, very careful, because the steps may be slick. I want you to ease in here. I asked Raven, I was telling Raven everything I was going to say. I had it all scripted out what I was going to say. And then I had a brilliant idea, Raven. I said, Raven, do you want to talk? And she said, yes. So, Raven, here's what I want you to tell them, okay? Tell them what you told me last week. By the way, Raven is 26 years old, and I want you to listen to what Raven shared.
I am going to be baptized, and I am 26 years old. And I told him I would be getting baptized when I'm a big girl.
Did you hear that?
Yes.
I want to make sure you heard that. I'm ready to be baptized like a big girl. I'm ready to be a big girl. Being a big boy, being a big girl, being a man, being a woman has nothing to do with how many years you've been on this earth. There are some old children in this room, senior adult children in this room. Because you've never decided. Here's what the Bible says. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I behaved as a child. But when I became a man, an adult, I put away my childish ways. That's what you're saying today, isn't it? Well, I'm going to ask Zach to come in here with us. I texted Zach yesterday, and I said, Zach, would you like the honor of baptizing Raven? And immediately, the response was yes. Raven, here's what we believe. According to your public profession of faith in Him, let me ask you something. Is Jesus Lord of your life?
Yes.
Public profession. We baptize you, not in the name of the church, but in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Y'all get on. Jordan's about to jump in. Go, go. Good job, all of you. To Haley, you may be seated. To Haley and Zach, thank you. To all the volunteers, thank you. But hear this plea. Hear this plea. More volunteers are needed. As God trusts us, He will send us more ravens. And we need more volunteers. And so see one of us, and we will make sure it's done. Scott? What? Got another one. Oh, look at you. I didn't know that. Come on in. Let me see if I can remember this. Wednesday night, you looked at me. Was it Wednesday? When was it? And you said you had watched the service, or you Tell me. Remind me.
The day before my birthday, I accepted Jesus.
Amen.
He's just been really calling me today. Rebaptized.
Wow. The curse is gone. And now, because of the cross, because of one man's disobedience, we were cursed. Because of one man, Jesus Christ, obedience, all have been forgiven. Is that what you claim?
Yes.
Is Jesus Christ the Lord of your life? Wait. That means boss. That means every day I surrender to the Lord. Is Jesus Christ your Lord?
Yes.
Then it is my honor. My sister. I'm going to ask you to bend your knees in just a second, all right? In just a second. I'm going to take care of you. I don't want you to worry about anything. I want you to clothe yourself. Do you remember what I just read from Galatians? Those that are baptized are clothed. I want you to be clothed from your head to your toes with the Lord Jesus Christ. I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Grab my arm. Buried just like Jesus. Risen to walk the newness of life. So proud of you. So proud of you. Anybody else? Now, while I'm looking out there, I would not call anybody out, but there's many of you that have been saved, and you've kind of put a pause on your baptism. There's nothing biblically wrong with that, but I want to remind you, we have an enemy that wants to steal. He wants to snatch that opportunity away from you, and you'll get dull. And you'll get numb, and then one day you'll say, oh, I'm just not going to be baptized. If you've been born again, let us know so that we can disciple you. Anybody else? Scott, I really hate to close the service. We're still going to worship with our tithes and our offerings, but you come and share anything that you feel like you need to share.